cars are like, you know, the end all and be all of what we need. But it's not that they're that rare. It's rare to mine them and refine them properly.
Precisely. And that's a big misconception. There's this assumption that because of the word rare, we just don't have enough. The real challenge and the real bottlenecks are both in the mining from a regional perspective and then on the processing, which is where the EU and the US is really looking to sort of step up its efforts.
So what does it mean in terms of exploration, but also in terms of recycling? Can you actually recycle this?
Very good question. So when it comes to exploration, you have rare earth and critical raw materials really displayed globally. China's got about 60% of sort of rare earth deposits. When it comes to the processing, their sort of appetite sort of reaches like 90%. When it comes to recycling, it's an interesting opportunity, but not all rare earth and critical raw materials can be recycled equally. From our research, it appears that magnetic rare earths have got the highest recycling capabilities, which is also positive because these are the materials that are going to be really important in uses such as EV batteries, thinking about defense applications as well. So promising, but it's going to take a long time to get sufficient recycling capacity.
Wait, is it as easy as recycling copper, or is it much more difficult because there are small components and actually it's quite difficult to get to?
Precisely. I would say it's probably closest to recycling, say, an EV battery. So you're using existing technology, which is encouraging. When we conducted our research, we weren't going to focus on recycling technologies that are on the near frontier. But using existing technologies, you can recycle particular rare earths, again, particularly sort of the magnetic ones. But as you mentioned, it's not just about being able to recycle them. You need to be able to collect them. When you get your rare earth, normally found in electronic components, where collection rates are incredibly low, you need to be able to get sufficient quantity to be able to recycle them. And that's the big bottleneck where we haven't seen policymakers really address yet.
So is the first step trying to find a reliable supply chain? So is everyone calling, you know, some of the countries that have them and refine them and trying to make deals?
It's interesting. I would say policymakers seem to be focusing on the end of the value chain. So a lot of the support has been focusing on companies who've got recycling capabilities, recycling infrastructure. That's where a lot of the financial support has been given. I would argue that the front end, where you need to get the supply chains, the spent waste, collection schemes, maybe requirements to have mandatory recycled content in devices, that has really been left. So I think there's a bit of a gap. It's been a bit of a chicken and egg situation in Europe and US looking at policy and investment so far.
Katherine, I mean, it's very, you know, we can't underestimate how much the green transition and also this burst of AI will do in terms of demand. So where are we in supply? I mean, if we were, you know, not to buy anymore or recycle anymore, like how long would we have left?
That's a really good question. I wouldn't say it in that particular way. I would say that recycling, when it comes to rare earths, isn't something that's going to mix the needle right now.
Okay.
Only 1% of rare earths are globally recycled, so it's really not making a material difference to supply chains at the moment.
When do we need to have more buy?
I would say if you look at sort of IEA data sets, by 2040, you're expecting recycling capacity to double. So that's quite some time when you're thinking about sort of capacity. So I think in the short term, it's really thinking about, are there alternative materials? Are you able to sort of broker broader deals? Are you able to look at sort of exploration and processing? Recycling is a long-term solution, but we'll need consistent policy, investment, and time to really manifest into something material.
So is the EU, for example, trying to go not against the US, but are they competing with the US, or can they both do their own thing?
I think there's space for both, because if you think about where rare earths are going to be, I think the smart way of thinking about it is once your electronics enter your market, you've got critical raw materials right there. So thinking about data center rollout, thinking about data center upgrades, there's a huge amount of rare earths in, say, wind turbines or within your particular region. So if you can focusing on your domestic supply chain and your domestic capacity, actually there should be a sensible amount of resources to start processing and recycling.
How much money do we need for this? Or how much money does the EU, and does it have it?
Well, that's the thing. The EU has focused particularly when it comes to critical raw materials in its broader act. They've sort of highlighted about 60 projects that they want to fund, giving about 500 million to each project. And to be honest, this is ranging from exploration, recycling, and processing. It's hard to create a sort of a single figure for this, but the number is incredibly high, and the time is going to take a long.
Is this private money or is it public money or is it a bit of both?
It's been a bit of both. I think you've seen, for example, in the US, quite a novel approach being taken. So companies like MP Materials receiving funding from the Trump administration. But also more recently, we've seen private critical raw materials companies also being given private funding as well.
What a terrific briefing. Thank you so much for joining us. Katherine Ogundiya, they're a thematic investing analyst at Barclays.